بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So today we are in juz number 8. Juz number 8, we go through two surahs, Surah Al-An'am verses 111 to the end, and Surah Al-A'raf from the beginning until verse number 87. Today's verse, inshallah ta'ala, is from Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 31. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya bani Adam, khudu zinatakum inda kulli masjid. O children of Adam, adorn yourself at every masjid. Wakulu washrabu wa la tusrifu. That and eat and drink and do not be excessive. Innahu la yuhibbul musrifin. Certainly Allah does not like those who are excessive. So let's break this down, inshallah ta'ala, this verse. First of all, in the beginning, Allah says, Ya bani Adam, khudu zinatakum inda kulli masjid. O children of Adam, adorn yourself at every masjid. Now I want to start with the word masjid. Now this can carry two meanings. Number one, this can be a physical masjid, or what we call a mosque, what's called in English. But masjid here also carries the meaning of any place that we would make sajda, or a place of sajda, a place of prostration. And any of that, any place where we would pray, we would prostrate, that is called a masjid. We have the hadith of Jabir bin Abdullah mentioned in Sunan al-Nasa'i, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Ju'ilat li al-ardu masjidan wa tahura." He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the earth has been made for me as a masjid. Masjid here meaning a place of prostration. The whole earth has been made for me as a place of prostration and a means of purification. And this is something special to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed us to pray anywhere. We could literally pray anywhere, with some exceptions. Obviously, we have to, if we know there's some impurity there or something like that, then we don't pray there unless we remove the impurity. But in general, the earth is vast and we can pray everywhere. Also, the earth has been made as a means of purification. One example of that is tayammum. We know that we can make tayammum with earth, with dirt. And this is a blessing, a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, alhamdulillah, this is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For me, I know people always say that if you're in the mall, go to the dressing room. I always find that to be very strange and odd. Like, I think it's just, I like to be as public as possible, because I feel like the more, and this might just be me, might just be like a thing in my head, but I'm like, the more you hide it, the more like suspicious it feels to me. So I like to do it in a place where like everybody can see me. So it's like, hey, I got nothing to hide. I'm here to pray. This is my salah, you know, as a Muslim, I'm praying. So I'll do it. I won't obviously do it in like the middle of, you know, the mall or something, but a corner, but not, you know, so people know I'm not trying to hide this, you know. But when you go into like a dressing room and stuff, it's like, I don't know, just to me it seems strange. Anyway, point is, the earth has been made as a place of prostration, a masjid. And so the first meaning here, when Allah says that, O children of Adam, adorn yourself or beautify yourself at every masjid. Of course, this means that when we go to the masjid, the physical structure itself, that we adorn ourselves and beautify ourselves. But also, when we are praying, right? Wherever we're praying, wherever we are doing our salah, that there should be that aspect of physical beautification as well. One of the reflections upon this verse is that, without a doubt, our physical beautification has an effect on our spiritual beautification. And what I mean by that is in every way. So when we, you know, look nice and we dress nice and we make an effort physically with our clothes and, you know, our dress and so on and so forth, that has an effect on our behavior as well. When something is important to us, we tend to dress up for it. And that's why, you know, when we go to a nice event, we dress up. When we go to a wedding, we dress up. And that's why I always used to tell like my students in Al-Maghrib, I say, look, we should be wearing like our nicest clothes when we come to Al-Maghrib seminars. Because that tells me that, you know, this is important to us. This gathering is important to us. And likewise, you know, even Jum'ah, we know in the Sharia, in Islam, we've been encouraged to make ghusl on the day of Jum'ah, wear our nicest clothes, to wear some perfume. Why? Because that is supposed to be an important event to us. That is why we dress up and we look nice. Now, just to give you a little bit of context regarding this verse, why was this verse revealed, or some of the reasons, or one of the reasons why this verse was revealed. There's a narration on Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, in which he said that the mushrikun at the time, in Jahili times, they would make tawaf around the Kaaba naked. And during the day it was men, and during the night it was women. That women would be completely uncovered, or at least from the chest, from the waist up. So bare-chested, and once again, apologies for not keeping it completely PG, but that is what would happen. And this is something which was forbidden in Islam. And that's one of the reasons of revelation of this verse, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, take your adornment or adorn yourself when you go to the masjid. And we have other narrations from other companions as well, telling us the same thing, that that was actually a practice that occurred in Jahili, in pre-Islamic times. That tells us actually that Islamically, there's two levels of dress or two levels of beautification. The first level of beautification is to cover our awra. Awra being that part of our body that is required for us to cover. So the first level of beautification for us is covering the awra. So a beautiful point here is that I should say covering the awra is considered beautification. And I say that as a important point here, because unfortunately, that, you know, in the times that we're living in today, right, we live in a society, where subhanAllah, beautification is seen in the opposite of that. So the more someone uncovers, the more someone exposes of themselves, the more it is considered beautification. The more nakedness there is, the more it's considered beautification. And this is the opposite of our fitrah, our natural inclination. This is opposite of beautification in Islam. So covering our awra is considered beautification. So that's the first level where we can say that's the bare minimum, no pun intended. But that's the bare minimum of beautification. That level of beautification is a requirement for all of us. So when we pray, when we go to the masjid, covering our awra is the requirement. The second level is that which is encouraged, and that is beautification that goes beyond covering our awra. That's the additional beautification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing us with here. So the first one being obligatory, when Allah says, Ya Bani Adam, khudu zinatakum inda kulli masjid, O children of Adam, adorn yourself at every masjid. First level, covering our awra, required. Second level, additional beautification. That is something which is encouraged in Islam. There's a lot to be said about beautification in Islam. Like I said, attend my seminar. There's a lot of detail on that. But I'll give you, just share with you a little bit, a few points, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, we have the famous hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, mentioned in Sahih Muslim, what is often known as the hadith of arrogance or the hadith of kibr. And in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man qala man kana fi qalbihi mithqalu dharra min kibr." A person who has even the tiniest amount of arrogance will not enter paradise. La yadkhul al-jannah. A person has even the tiniest amount of arrogance will not enter paradise. Upon hearing this, one person who was there in that gathering, he said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, what about a person likes that their clothes be nice and their shoes be nice? What about that? You know, is that considered arrogance?" And that is the question here. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he replied, "Inna Allaha jamilun wa yuhibbul jamal," that Allah is beautiful, or certainly Allah is beautiful, and He loves beauty. And so here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is encouraging this companion and saying, look, if you're doing it for the sake of Allah, meaning if you're not doing it out of arrogance, then this is something that is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then defined arrogance and said, al-kibr batar al-haq wa ghamtu an-nas. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, arrogance is rejecting the truth, or being averse to the truth, or having contempt for people, or putting people down. Now, what does that mean? That means if a person thinks so highly of themselves that, you know, someone comes to them with facts, someone comes to them with the truth, they're like, no, who are you to tell me what's right and what's wrong? That is arrogance. Likewise, to have contempt for people or to put people down, think you're so think so highly of yourself that you look down at other people, that is arrogance. Now, can our clothing and our shoes and our beautification be a source of that? Absolutely. If our clothing makes us think that we are better than other people and we put people down because they don't dress like us or they're not as good looking as us or whatever, yes, that becomes arrogance. But simply dressing nice and looking nice and beautifying ourselves is not only is that not arrogance, it is, and not only is it not impermissible, it is something which is encouraged in Islam, And the level of beautification, as we said, which is covering of our awrah, that is not just encouraged, but that is a requirement in our deen. So that is the beautification that we're talking about. Another hadith of the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in Sunan at-Tirmidhi, hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-As, in which the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ, that certainly Allah loves to see the signs of his bounties upon his servant or upon his slave. Meaning Allah likes that we speak of Allah's beauty, and Allah likes that we beautify ourselves and attribute that beauty to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ, as Allah says, as for the favors of your Lord upon you, or the blessings of your Lord upon you, then speak of them, right? And meaning we should proclaim the bounties of Allah, the favors of Allah. And amongst that is, if we have something nice, whether it be clothing or anything else, really, for that matter, that Allah likes that we speak of it when we attribute it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I know there's this general feeling amongst a lot of Muslims that if we have to have something nice, they should hide it because they don't want to show off, right? So if they get like a nice car or they have nice clothes or whatever it may be, like they don't want to show it to people because like, oh, I don't want people to think that I'm showing off, or I don't want to be a show off. Well, that is not how it should be. What the way we should behave is we should show those things while attributing it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Because that is actually praise of Allah and not praise of ourselves. Yes, it becomes arrogance when we say, you know, like what Qarun said, إِنَّمَا أُتِيتُهُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. He said, I've been given this because of my knowledge. So he's attributing all of what he has to himself, right? It's because of me, because of my abilities, my knowledge that I have everything that I have, all the nice things I have in my life, they're because of me. And that, yes, that is arrogance. But to attribute it to Allah is something which is praiseworthy and something which is good. That is why we say, Masha'Allah. We say it is by the will of Allah. In Surah Al-Kahf, we have the story of the people with the garden and, you know, the person who became arrogant with his garden. The other man, he said to him, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ, that if you were to only enter your Jannah and say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ, it is by the will of Allah. Meaning it's not because of anything that I, nothing for me to be proud about, right? That this is me, I did this, I deserve this, and so on and so forth. Rather, it is by the will of Allah. لا قوّة إلا بالله. There's no power, no might other than Allah. Attributing our blessings to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is when our beautification becomes praiseworthy. That is when our beautification becomes something which is good and praiseworthy, and it's something to feel good about. And the best type of beautification, subhanAllah, to really feel good about yourself and to increase your self-esteem, to increase your self-worth, is to beautify yourself and know that in beautifying yourself, not only like you feel good about the way you look, but you attribute it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So on a material, physical level, you feel good, and on a spiritual level, you feel good as well. And that is why it is always important to make the intention that we are doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we're beautifying ourselves for the sake of Allah. And that doesn't mean that we don't feel good about the way we look. As the hadith that we mentioned, the hadith of arrogance shows us that this person said, what if a person likes that their clothes be nice and their shoes be nice? And the Prophet ﷺ replied directly with, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ وَيُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ, Allah is beautiful and Allah loves, and he loves beauty. So there's nothing wrong with feeling good about the way we look and, you know, being presentable and nice and, you know, all of that. But also that spiritual aspect a beautification should be there as well. And then we add to that this issue of attaching beautification to acts of worship, then that just takes it to like another, like a higher level, subhanAllah, that we're going to the masjid and we're beautifying ourselves, we're being involved in an act of worship, and that becomes purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why, for me, this has always been one of those points that, you know, it's not only, it's like one of those really good feel-good points that I always try to encourage with like the, especially the younger generation, that, you know, we as Muslims, as believers, should really make an effort to look nice and dress nice. And obviously we all have different abilities and so on and so forth. And it's not just about, you know, our bodies, because, you know, having issues with our bodies, that's like a whole nother issue when it comes to, you know, our self-image and all of that, and you know, body image, that's another issue. But beautification in terms of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us and the effort that we put into what Allah has given to us, that is where we can feel good about ourselves in that effort that we make. And so this is something I do try to, as I said, I do try to encourage with the younger generation, because if we look at the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is amazingly beautiful in this leeway that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us to express ourselves through our beautification and through our clothes. And not only, as I said earlier, to emphasize this point, not only is it to that we feel good about ourselves, but it is an act of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we attribute that to Allah, and especially when we attach it to our, you know, our identity as Muslims. And that should be part of our identity, is that we as Muslims make an effort to, you know, to whatever our ability is, it, you know, to look nice and to dress nice and so on and so forth. And that's actually one of the reasons why, and I don't really talk about this much, but I will mention it here because this is a special case. That's actually one of the reasons why I started my own clothing line, because I looked at, for me, it was very simple. There's actually two reasons. Number one, I have creative needs. I'm a creative person by nature. That's just, you know, I've even growing up, subhanAllah, I love to draw and be creative and so on and so forth. And because of, you know, my da'wah work and teaching, I don't get a lot of time to express myself artistically. So to be able to design clothes, and I just started actually designing clothes for myself, that allowed me to fulfill my creative needs. But beyond that, I looked, it became very clear to me that if you look at the Muslim space, and if you look at, you know, you can, you know, divide up into brothers and sisters, in the sisters space, there's a lot going on. There's like, you know, a million hijab companies and abaya companies and Muslim fashion and like Muslim women's fashion. And like, there's so much going on, right? Every day there seems to be a new hijab company and hijab pins and this and that, or whatever it may be. But if you look at the men's space, the brothers, what do we have? Do we have any brands? Do we have anything that in the Muslim space, outside the Muslim space, yeah, there's plenty going on. But in the Muslim space, are there any Muslim men's brands that we can say, you know what, this is fashionable, or this is high fashion even? And I was like, why is there such a void here? And to me, I was like, okay, we need to fill this void. Part of it is, yeah, for myself, but I also want to inspire young people, young men, because I think men oftentimes get left out of this conversation, because a lot of times beautification is associated with women and not with men. But, you know, men should beautify themselves as well. And actually in trends in my seminar, we actually mention examples from the Sunnah and from the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, who would take put a lot of effort into the way they dress and the way they looked. Even, you know, we talk about in that seminar, we talk about hairstyles. And we have this subhanAllah, this idea that all of the Sahaba looked exactly the same and dressed exactly the same, and, you know, their beards and their hair, it was exactly the same. And that was absolutely not the case. The Sahaba had different hairstyles. They did different things with their beards and their hair and their clothes and so on and so forth. Just to mention a few, by the way, since we're on the topic, right? And this is something I like talking about anyway. Some Sahaba would comb their hair straight back. Some Sahaba would part their hair. Some of the companions, They had shorter hair. Some of the companions had longer hair, even though, by the way, the norm amongst men at that time were that men generally grew their hair long. That was the norm. Braids were common. The different types of braids were common. It was a common practice, especially when working and traveling. The men would braid their hair or put their hair in braids. We have a specific narration of when the Prophet ﷺ entered Mecca. During the opening of Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ had 3 or 4 braids in his hair. And that was normal. And nobody looked at that and said, oh, that's odd, right? It's odd that men are being fashionable with their hair, because they understood that Islam didn't come to change that. Islam gave us certain boundaries that as long as we stay within those boundaries, we are free to express ourselves in that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made halal. Right? And that is why we do find different hairstyles and different ways of people combing their hair and making their hair. And even one of the practices that the companions had was that they would take like animal fat and they would squeeze it into, like they had long hair, they would like squeeze it into their hair to bunch their hair together. You know, and we do this today, you know, we have gel and hair products and so on and so forth. And I know, subhanAllah, I remember specifically, you know, when I first started public speaking or whatever, some of the comments that I would get online, they're like, what kind of imam are you? Like, what kind of sheikh are you? Like, you put gel in your hair and you like, what's going on here? Like, that's so weird. And I was like, wait a minute. Like, what has happened to our sense of religiosity that as soon as we see someone who looks nice, we automatically think they must not be a good Muslim or they must not be religious or they must not have knowledge, because as a good Muslim, you're supposed to look crummy, right? And like, when did this happen to our ummah that we associate looking bad with being religious or pious? You know, this actually started, subhanAllah, in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar would notice, radiallahu anhu arda'ahu, he would notice that even in his time, there were those who would wear like tattered clothes and dirty clothes. And sometimes there's a couple narrations where people would walk with their backs hunched over, you know, and out of a false sense of piety, out of a false sense of religiosity. In one occasion, Umar radiallahu anhu, he saw a man walking like this. And he went up to him and he said, what is wrong with you? Are you sick? Are you ill? Like, are you okay? Like, what's the problem here? And he goes, no, nothing. You know, I just, you know, I love Allah. And, you know, and he's trying to make the excuses. And Umar radiallahu anhu, he got upset with him. And he said, ya akhi, la tamut alayna dinana. He said, oh, my brother, don't kill our religion for us. Meaning don't make it into something that it's not. Don't show people that this is what Islam is, that to be pious, to be a muttaqi, you have to look like this, right? That you have to be completely disconnected from the dunya and so on and so forth. This is not what our deen teaches us. Bil'aks, our deen teaches us that we make an effort, that we pay attention to the way we look. And in that, and not just for, not for, hey, I want to look nice in front of people and so on and so forth, or because we're slaves to what, you know, the society defines as beauty and so on and so forth. No, our standards of beauty go back to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us, right? And that's why number one is covering our awrah, right? The Islamic requirements for our clothing and dress and so on and so forth. And within that, and within those boundaries, within those parameters that Allah has given to us, yes, we beautify ourselves for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why, for the sake of Allah, and also, other good intentions. One of my favorite narrations is the narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, in which he said, "Inni uhibbu an atazayyana limra'ati kama uhibbu an tatazayyana li." He said, radiallahu anhu, he said, "I love to beautify myself for my wife just as I love for her to beautify herself for me." Subhanallah. Amazing, amazing narration, because here, what he's saying is, just as I like that my wife beautifies herself for me, right? And we all, subhanAllah, we appreciate it when you know, a loved one makes an effort or does something nice for us, right? We don't all show that appreciation, but we like it. We like it when someone does something for us. And, you know, a spouse, you know, beautifying themselves for their husband or their wife, that is something that, you know, Ibn Abbas, he says, I love it. I really enjoy it when my wife, just as I enjoy it, just as I love that my wife makes an effort to beautify herself for me, in the same way, I love to beautify myself for my wife. Number one, notice that he is saying, he's talking about equality or equity 1,500 years ago, right? About, you know, in the relationship, we have to match the effort. We have to try to do as much as we can in the relationship. Just whatever I expect from my wife, he's saying, I want to do that even more, right? This is what Ibn Abbas is saying. This is the level of commitment that Ibn Abbas says that goes into our relationships. And then not only that, he's talking about how he loves to beautify himself. And any imam or scholar or public figure that says that today, I can tell you there's a group of people who are like, what kind of imam is this? And I can tell you firsthand experience, subhanAllah. If you look at a lot of my videos, subhanAllah, that are online, somewhere in that video, there's going to be a comment about my dress, like the way I'm dressed or my hair or something like that. It's always something in there is about like, what kind of imam is this? Like, what kind of, like, it's always there. It's come to a point now in our ummah that so many people don't understand this very point and this false sense of piety of, you know, we have to look, we can't look nice, you know, if we are religious or pious or anything like that. And so here, you know, this ayah here is a very clear indication where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that tie between our worship, our acts of worship and looking nice and dressing nice. And then Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, and eat and drink, but don't be excessive. Don't do israf. Now, let me quickly just define here what israf means. We'll talk about general israf and then israf that is specific to food and drink. So general israf is any one of three things. Number one, to spend on anything which is haram or impermissible is considered israf, right? Even if it's the tiniest of amount, even if it's a dollar or a pound or a euro or wherever you live, whatever the currency is, even the smallest amount of that currency or a penny, right? It's not about the amount, it's about what we're spending on. So to spend upon something that Allah has made impermissible is considered israf. Number two is to spend beyond one's means, to spend beyond what one is capable of spending. And generally what that means is to spend on something which is not a necessity when there are necessities that we should be spending on. For example, and this is an example that I give in my class, do you think it is israf or do you think it is excessive to spend $120 on a haircut? Oh, by the way, talking about men here, not women. I know, you know, women's prices for, you know, going to the salon or whatever may be different. For men, is it considered excessive to spend, is it considered israf to spend $120 on a haircut? It very much depends. It depends on who is spending those $100 or $120. If a person is wealthy and they can afford it and they're taking care of their responsibilities, they're taking care of their needs and they're comfortably able to spend $120. And let's say, you know, this person gives charity and so on and so forth, then for them to spend $120 on a haircut is not considered israf. On the other hand, a brother who's struggling to pay the bills, to provide for his family, a brother who's struggling to pay for his children's education and to provide for his wife, for that person to go out and spend $120 on a haircut would be considered israf. So it depends on the individual here. Number three is to spend on something which has zero, zero, zero value, which is pretty much just to waste your money. So let's say someone took like a crisp $100 bill and threw it in the lake, right? That would be considered israf. No matter how wealthy this person is, to spend on something that has no value whatsoever would be considered israf. Now, when we talk about value, value can also be subjective, right? So some people may value something over another. I know there's plenty of things that I've spent money on that my wife personally does not value at all. To her, there's no value. Like, why would you spend this money on that? And likewise, my wife will sometimes spend money on something that I have no value for. So that is subjective, but we're talking about something that is objectively has no value, right? So like to flush some money down the toilet, that is considered israf, or to throw away one's money that brings no benefit, no value to anyone. And that is something which is considered israf. So in general, any of those three things is considered Israf. And israf is something which is prohibited and forbidden in Islam. Specifically, when it comes to israf in food and drink, it's also three things. Number one, to consume something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram. That will be considered israf, even if someone takes a single sip or a single bite. That is considered israf. Number two, to consume that which is harmful to our bodies or harmful to us. And in general, one and two can be together. One and two can be considered together. And number three is to consume beyond what would be sufficient to us. And this is where we get into the topic of like overeating and things like that. Now, I just want to clarify a couple of issues here. It is, so overeating in general is something which is discouraged in Islam. We have so many narrations, so many hadith of the Prophet where overeating is discouraged. For example, we had the famous hadith mentioned in Sunan at-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah and others, in which the Prophet he said, the child of Adam doesn't fill any vessel worse than the stomach. It is sufficient for the child of Adam to eat enough to basically, and the hadith says, to keep their back upright, but basically enough to sustain them, to keep going and to be comfortable. And then the Prophet said that if they must, then they should eat a third of their stomach. They should fill a third of their stomach with food, a third with drink, and a third should be لنفسه, meaning it's enough to breathe, that almost as if it is left empty. This is the norm for a believer. This is the norm in how we should be eating. With another hadith mentioned in the Sahihain, the Prophet said, the food for one is enough for two, food for two is enough for three, and food for three is enough for four. In general, what this means is whatever you think is enough, cut it down a little bit, right? Whatever you think, oh, this is a meal for me, cut it down a little bit from that. A good habit, if you want to implement the sunnah, every time you got to eat with your friends, implement the sunnah, right? So if there's three of you, order enough food for two. If there's four of you, enough order enough food for three, and so on and so on and so forth, to implement the sunnah of the Prophet. And what you will find, subhanAllah, is blessings in this food that you're going to eat. One statement by Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, I have not filled my stomach in 16 years, which subhanAllah, to hear something like that, and in the world, in the society we live in today, is almost unheard of when people, you know, live in it and belong to a social class that can comfortably eat. Most people don't live like that. But Imam Shafi'i, he said, in 16 years, I have not filled my stomach. He says, because what does it do? It makes the body heavy. It removes clear understanding. It makes one sleepy, and it makes one lazy or tired or weak in their worship. And Imam Shafi'i was known to have an amazing memory, subhanAllah. And people think that almost that it is impossible for someone in this day and age to have a memory like that. But you also have to look at the lifestyle of Imam Shafi'i, how he lived his life. And something like this gives us some insight into why Imam Shafi'i was given that blessing of having an amazing memory. And not only that, an amazing understanding of the deen, tafaqquh fi al-deen, an amazing understanding of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, that being said, is it haram to eat till you're full? No, it's not haram to do that. It is discouraged. It is highly discouraged, depending on how full we get. There are narrations where there are sahaba who ate until they're full. And so what that teaches us is that to eat till you're full every now and then is okay, is fine. But that shouldn't be our norm. And which is the opposite of the way we live today. A lot of people live where every day they eat until they're full. Every now and then they'll eat less and they'll be like, oh, I feel great about myself today. I feel so healthy, I know, because I ate less today, right? It should be the other way around. That, subhanAllah, that in our norm should be that we don't fill ourselves up till the point where we can't breathe. You know, we feel heavy, we feel burdened. Someone said itis, and so whoever said itis knows exactly what I'm talking about here, right? You got the itis, meaning like you're done, right? You need to lay down, food coma, you need to pass out. It's okay to do that now and then. And there's one narration in which the Prophet allowed and had a companion do that, but that companion was actually very poor. was not able to eat very much in their life, and that was the exception to the norm. So every now and then, inshallah ta'ala, it is okay to do that, but our general lifestyle should be that we don't eat until we're till we're full. So this verse says, "Wakulu washrabu," that eat and drink, meaning it is okay and it is good to enjoy the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once again, as long as we're attributing, just like our clothing and dress and beautification, as long as we are attributing those blessings to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't restrict our eating and drinking in the sense of making things haram upon ourselves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made haram, right? But at the same time, being moderate and balanced in the way we eat to take care of our bodies and to take care of ourselves.